Hello everyone. Hello. Welcome to yet another edition of MarTech Brain, an EdCore initiative where we speak to the best brains in MarTech and digital and delve deep into one topic. My guest today is Subhadra Vaidyanathan, Head Digital Marketing and Business, HDFC Bank. Her chosen topic for our conversation is personalization and analytics. Welcome to MarTech Brain, Subhadra.
Thank you, Rajesh. Good to connect with you. Thanks for having me.
Pleasure. So let's start with a simple question. Why is personalization so important? Now, everyone talks about personalization, omni-channel personalization. So why has this become so important?
So I think it's personalization, something that's always been important, but in this last few decades, it's become even more because on the digital side, at least, there's so much clutter in the digital space. There's just so much you keep seeing extra content. And that's one side, there's on the supply side. And on the receiving side, consumers' attention span has also gone down so much that if you do not catch their attention within a split second, within a couple of seconds, you've lost that consumer. So from both sides, in a digital sense, personalization is becoming and has become a lot more important now than it was perhaps 15, 20 years ago when you started, your internet business. But now it is definitely table stakes. Everybody's got to be doing it to maintain a certain level of efficiency.
So now when we go a little deeper into personalization, I think there are many aspects of personalization. When we look at who is the customer, what to communicate to him or her, how do we operationalize the delivery of personalized experiences, how do we measure, improve, and we'll go into each of these topics.
Sure.
But let's start with the customer. So tell us a little bit more on how would you think about the customer and how do you then start the process of personalization?
Yeah. So, from a digital point of view, we do have we are lucky that in the last two decades, there's so many tools that have come up that we have a lot of data, and that data leads us to an understanding of who is the customer. So primarily, once we integrate any tool, like any analytical tool, whether it's a Google Analytics or an Adobe Analytics, it starts collecting a lot of data. And the way in which it is implemented, if you also integrate it with a backend data that we also have, if the customer is already engaged with you, I mean, we run a bank, so we already have a lot of information about people who are already banking with us, right? So using all of this data, we at the bare minimum, we know, is this person who is visiting the website or the app, is he somebody who's already banking with us or he's not banking with us? Yes, there are some limitations of technology, which is, because it's on the basis of cookies. So if people clear their cookies, then we lose that data. That's the reality of how it is today. But as long as the cookies are there, it helps us to identify who is that customer. And then we use our team of data scientists, use all of the analytical models to profile those customers. So if somebody who is already banking with us, we have a lot of data about their activity, which helps us to profile that, okay, this person, either from a geolocation point of view, the type of bank account he has, the type of transactions he or she is doing, and so on. It helps us to then profile customers. If the customer is not banking with us, even so, today's tools have a lot of algorithms built in that using the data that is collected digitally, we use the machine learning tools that are inbuilt into Google Analytics or Adobe Analytics, the Sensei and all of that, helps to profile customers to build lookalikes that while this person is currently new to us, he looks like so-and-so who's already banking. And so whether he's an existing customer or a new customer, we are able to profile using data, both sets of data. One is data which we're collecting in real time digitally. And second is data, if it's an existing customer, data which we've collected in the past. And that enriches our understanding of who is that customer which helps us then to decide the next steps of what is it that we want to communicate and so on.
And I'm also presuming that even if there's an offline interaction, even all of that data also, so even if I'm, say, going to a branch, etc., so even offline and online, all of the data is aggregated together.
Yes. So, you know, one thing must say that it takes a while to get all of that, right? So, I think it's taken us definitely a good 2.5-3 years to reach that level where a lot of that offline data is also now brought in. So I think rather than boil the entire ocean in one stretch, we start with a little bit. We started with whatever data was already existing in our transactional systems. Then we brought in the digital data also. And in bits and pieces, we kept adding in more and more data, which is, you know, full credit to the data science team that they've been able to get us in the last 2.5-3 years to a level where today almost all of the data, I won't say all though, there's still a wealth of data that exists, which is not yet brought in. But then you need to also sort of do that trade-off to see how much more data and how much more incremental impact will that have, and is it worth that effort and cost? That's always a question you have to keep evaluating. But yes, you're right that a lot of offline, or at least a fair amount of offline data is also brought in to as long as it helps to deliver impact on the model.
And so essentially, so what we are saying is that what a very good point you said is that you don't have to wait to get the perfect solution. Whatever data is available, get started.
Yes.
And all of this data goes into a CDP, a customer data platform, and that's what becomes the full repository. And then the analytical teams are working on that to then work out, in a way, perhaps, what is the next best action, next best offer?
Absolutely.
That's what we want to take to the customer.
Yes. So I think there again, there's been a journey. So I think initially it was more very specific to purchase propensity. So, you know, models were built product centric. So let's say if the product is a savings account, then what's the purchase propensity for that account or for a fixed deposit or for a loan and so on. But I think the team always knew that we want to move towards more of a customer centric, and it's taken a fair amount of effort to get that data in place. But now that it's there, we move to, like you said, a next best action, which is a very customer centric, that if this is Rajesh who is coming onto the site, what's the next best thing to state rather than what is his purchase propensity for a car loan or for a home loan. You know, they're very different in orientation. But that definitely has, we've reached that stage and we are seeing good results from that as well.
So also, what's probably happening is that earlier we used to segment customers, so cohorts, etc., would get created, and now it's also becoming more one-to-one in a way, right? Because of all the data that's available.
Yes. So yes, there is, and that depends on channels, right? So one-to-one is possible. One again needs to evaluate, is it worth it to do that one-to-one personalization? And depending on the channel, is it feasible or not? Because certain channels and tools or technologies allow you to do that one-to-one. In others, let's say particularly on paid platforms, like if I'm advertising on Instagram or Google search or wherever else, the one-to-one is not even feasible, and I don't know if it is really worth it. It could be pretty creepy. So yeah, we don't really want to go there either.
Absolutely.
So depending on the channel, however, for instance, on our own platform, let's say in the banking side or on the mobile app, etc., a one-to-one is possible, and we do see that it does drive impact in terms of a lift, in terms of the click-through rates, etc. We do see a definite improvement in a one-to-one personalization.
So this brings us sort of to the next question, is that you've now collected all the data, and therefore now, how do you decide what to communicate?
Right.
How do you make that decision?
So I think what to communicate is a function of, it's a function of our understanding of the customer itself, you know, the profile of the customer, the intent of the customer in that instant, because all of this communication is happening in real time at that point in time. So, you know, what is his intent? And a fair amount of crafting of that communication, which is the how to communicate. But the what to communicate, I would say it's we do a fair amount of testing there, because, you know, we may have a view that, you know, to communicate about, let's say, a home loan, we believe, perhaps we may start with a hypothesis that what's important for the customer is the interest rate. So we may start with communicating, you know, we have the lowest interest rates or whatever, but we may, you know, when we test out with different segments, you may see that perhaps there is a different segment where convenience of no documentation or something else is more important. And that what to communicate, we'll have to have multiple hypotheses, develop that communication, and really do the testing to see what works or what doesn't work. The second part of it is really also the ability to communicate in real time. So what the tool allows you to communicate, along with the intelligence coming from the CDP, like you said, the segmentation audience manager, or the tool where the segments are the repository, based on all of that, the what to communicate. So you earlier spoke about smaller segments or a one-to-one. While we don't, one-to-one is like the one end of the extreme. But we find a lot of micro segments where, you know, depending on whether the customer is already banking with us, and if he is already banking with us, what's the kind of offers that we already have, you know. There are a set of customers, maybe depending on their profile, where we know we don't need any documentation and they're already approved for a certain set of products, versus there are other customers where maybe we need some documentation or KYC or things like that. So that's where the what to communicate comes into effect, where we then, that subsegment of customers, we can always say no documentation, you can get the product at any time of day or night within a matter of minutes, just do it online. Versus the other set of customers, we do need a documentation, so we can't communicate that. So we'll need to then, you know, try other communication hooks and accordingly take them to the right application journey, which, you know, because they can't do it completely digitally, we need to give them an assisted journey and so on. So the what to communicate is really, what I'm trying to say is, it's a function of who is the customer and the ability of the CDP to transfer that intelligence to the front-end tool, whichever it is that we're using to do the communication, in an intelligent manner, and then we set up that communication for the customer.
And in the analytical side, presumably now in the last few years, what we've also seen is the rise of machine learning. So yes. It's not just humans making the decisions, but machines are, AI ML is playing a big role.
Oh, yes.
You can drive this in almost near real time.
Yes. So yes, you're right. That's the other part of the what to communicate, right? Because while a lot of this traditionally, I mean, I started doing analytics in 98 with GE, where it was all about using a lot of backend data. And then in a batch mode, you do a predictive model. Whereas today the world it's real time. Like you're saying, there are tools, there's machine learning, which is running in real time, that based on the data that's gathered, then and there it's, you know, fitting the customer into a certain cohort or a certain segment. And that adds a lot of additional insight, because, I mean, if you take a real world example, based on our analytics, it might, you know, our analytics might say that, hey, Rajesh is, you know, based on all the data, given that he's called the call center a couple of times inquiring about an auto loan, say, for example, our analytics say that he is interested in an auto loan. So next time he visits the bank, the digital section, you know, explain, you know, tell him that he's already pre-approved maybe for an auto loan. But the real-time data, when you actually visit the site, if, let's say, you start exploring about fixed deposit interest rates, that real-time intelligence, the machine learning has to pick up and say, look, right now his intent is more to look at a fixed deposit, not auto loan. So prioritize a fixed deposit communication and immediately switch him into a segment which is for fixed deposit and deliver that communication. So all of that is the beauty is that is now possible with real-time machine learning algorithms. And this is like for an example for somebody who's already banking with us. But like I said, people who are not banking with us, it's the real-time machine learning algos which help us to profile them as lookalikes of people who are already banking and then communicate the right offer to them.
So in a way, in operationalizing all of this, what you're really saying is that there is some amount of art and some amount of science.
Yes.
Okay, so there is, of course, the data science, the machine learning part, correct, and then also the human who has to work out and test out different messages.
Yes.
Which have to be crafted.
Oh, yes, absolutely. So it's good you brought that because it's truly an art and a science. The science part of it is twofold, right? One is the entire data science, the analytical science of it. And there's the second, which is the technical science of it. So we have teams of people who are data scientists who know how to build these models and fine tune them, etc., to give the right prediction. Then there are teams of, we also need people who know the tools and the technology really well. So whether the tool is a personalization tool or the tool is the audience manager, the CDP itself, people need to know how the tool works so that you can really apply it in the right way, how to do the prioritization. If you have multiple communications set up with multiple frequency cappings, so you need people with that science or understanding of that technology to know how it will work and ensure that it delivers the communication in the way it is intended to. All of that is the science part. But the art of it is really the traditional, what we call marketing, which is, you know, what is the communication design, it's the visual, it's the language, it's the tonality. So in the last 3-4 years, our CMO has been forcing us all to use behavioral science, behavioral economics, so various principles of behavioral economics to sort of craft the communication. So the same product can be communicated with so many different emotions or different tonalities. And, you know, the beauty is, you know, if you'd said 30, 40 years ago, if I were working with Hindustan Livers, and we would probably work with an ad agency and they would design this. And you know, oh, this ad is fantastic. It really pulls at my heartstrings and all of that. But we couldn't measure it. The beauty is now in digital, we can actually measure it. And we know exactly this is the kind of lift we are getting because we changed the image of this. It's the same banner, let's say. Instead of having the image of, let's say, a middle-aged lady, let's say we put the banner of a, and we actually did, we used the face of a little baby on one of our banners, a very cute smiling baby, and we saw such a good lift in the click-through rate. It was amazing. It was unbelievable. So that's the art of it, that you keep, and it may work with one audience, with one segment, it may not work with another. So that's the second art of it, is to know, okay, just because this particular baby-faced banner worked doesn't mean it will work across the board. There is an art to knowing which audience it will work with, which product or which context it will work in, perhaps time of day of week, all of those factors also. So there's so much that one can keep testing for and keep improving, and the nuances of that communication, to me, that is the art of it. And that's sort of this pure joy in trying to keep identifying something new that may work. So I it just excites me tremendously.
In some ways, you really have, in a way, the power of God, where you're able to now run probably a million experiments, you know, with color, with language, with images. And then the machine is basically telling you, okay, for this segment, this is working better, that is working better. It's really incredible, the ability then to sort of really target the messaging. true for the maximum response.
Absolutely, absolutely. It's I hadn't thought of it as power of God, but that makes it sound a little scary. But
I can imagine you sitting there. There's this big dashboard in front, and you know exactly what's happening. Okay, this group, this is working very well. That group, that is working very well. And all you've got to say is yes, go ahead with this or go ahead with that.
That reminds me of that movie, the social experiment.
Yes, on the one on Facebook.
On Facebook and Google, yes. And all of that. And it was, that's what we are doing right now, right? But it is at one level, you wonder where is that border and at what point are you crossing the threshold? But yes, it's fascinating.
In a way, and in fact, what was nice in the movie, besides all the stuff that they talked about, was they humanized the machines.
Yes.
You know, they had these people sitting there at the back telling, it brought it alive. I mean, the whole machines, which are basically there, they come alive. Now, one of the innovations that I think you all also have been doing is really the ability to also adapt language.
Yes.
Earlier, a lot of it probably would be in English because we didn't know, what language would be comfortable with. And that's, of course, a big addition to what you've been doing.
Yes. So that's, I think we've kind of also evolved along with the internet usage in the country itself. So I think like any other business, initially every digital thing starts in English. And in the last year or so, we've started testing with vernacular language across various channels. And we are starting to see a good traction. And I think this is something, you know, even 2-3 years ago, it was the mantra everywhere was voice, vernacular, and videos. And definitely, in my view, video and vernacular have taken off tremendously, especially in this last 1 year after lockdown and all of that. Obviously, the videos has shot up. And vernacular, because everybody whether it is in the metros or in the rural areas or semi-urban areas, everybody is dependent and has adapted to using digital. So as digital usage has gone up in all of the interiors of the country, automatically people are more comfortable with their mother tongue or their familiar language. And that's on in terms of the consumer trend, and on the technology side also, tools have enabled us to be able to deliver communication in multiple languages using segmentation and using real-time data to saying that, okay, if this person is logging in right now, he is coming in from UP, let me show him the Hindi communication instead of the English and so on. And we do see a lift in the engagement rate across, definitely we've tried it on our website, we've tried it on mobile app, we've tried it on WhatsApp, we've tried it on paid platforms like Facebook and so on. And across the board, we definitely see a lift in vernacular versus English. There again, I think there is that art of it, while the tool is there, the art involves then... I think that's where the challenge is, that the ability to communicate the message in that vernacular language. One, either you need to have someone who really knows that language and knows how to use the nuances of that language. So that's a manual work. If you use an automated tool to do the translation or the automated using APIs, etc., then it doesn't work as effectively. But I think that's a journey also, and we'll make progress along that as things improve.
You also talked about measurement, basically about the lift, etc. So what do you really look for? How do you, okay, so you're running all these campaigns. How do you compare whether this one is doing better and it's versus what? How do you benchmark?
Yeah, so I think the first part of measurement, the art or the experience in measurement really comes in from knowing first what to measure. And that you start with what is the business objective? What's the objective of the campaign or the communication? Is it to increase business, let's say in terms of sales? Is it to increase the time engaging the customer with in terms of viewing a particular content, whether it is textual, video? Depending on what that objective it is that you want to achieve, the metric or the KPI has to be very carefully picked. You cannot use the same click-through rate KPI for all, because then, you know, you're not really measuring the right thing. So that's one one thing I always am cognizant of, that, you know, whenever we run experiments, the first thing as a team we think about is, yes, sir, we will do all of this, but how are we going to measure? What will be that metric? And that's what is the metric is one. The second is, how will we measure it? Like, obviously, tools will collect a lot of data, but for measuring this metric, what is the data that you will use to actually measure it? So defining what is the metric is an important, I'd say, an art, or it's more of an art. It comes with the experience of having run the campaigns. And then how do you measure it? So that's where, you know, I spoke about knowing the tool. So if you're using, let's say, a Google Analytics tool, knowing that the tool collects data for a session and this data is valid only for this particular session, whereas there are so many nuances to knowing how that data is collected, how that tool is defining a particular data element. And that's important to know, because that impacts the way you interpret that metric or the measure, right? If the tool says this is the bounce rate, you need to know exactly how that particular tool is defining bounce rate, which requires some understanding or experience with the tool, the knowledge of the tool. And I think the third part is really, you can measure all of this. And to answer your question, ideally, in a pure world, you should have a test and a control, where the control group is, they're not exposed to anything, and there's a test group where you're exposing the communication to, which it's in an ideal world. But the reality is, given people are, everyone's, you know, consumers are accessing so many channels, reality is kahin na kahin they are seeing some communication. So even if you define it as a control group for a particular channel, let's say for mobile app, that consumer is probably seeing that communication on the website, or he's seeing it on SMS or somewhere. So we prefer to just look at it as a lift over the current communication. So if current BAU is showing a certain click-through rate or a lead submission rate or a conversion rate, this is the incremental CTR that we are getting over and above what we are achieving today. To me, that feels more, that is actually more practical than being able to devise and outline a universal control group which will be kept absolutely untouched, because that never happens in reality. The other part of measurement really that I did want to talk about was the critical aspect is, how do you interpret? So all of these, the tools will help you to collect the data, and you know, you can define what is the metric. But once you get a metric, let's say a CTR of 1.3%, and let's say that 1.3% is, if your normal BAU click-through rate is 1.1 and you got 1.3, so you know, okay, 0.2 lift. That's good. Question is that good? Is that bad? Can it get better? That there again is an art involved, because, you know, there's no science which, there statistics may say, okay, 0.2 over 1.1 is statistically significant or whatever, but so what? What does it mean for the business? Can that 0.2% incremental CTR, can that grow to 0.7? And if so, which factor should we change the communication? Should you change the segment itself? Should you further segment it? And in the communication, there's so many things, right? Like you said, there's the language, there's the visuals, there's how many times you should expose him, what's the right frequency. There's so many factors that you can play around with. Like you said, you can be God there. So to me, that you can keep doing this. The other part is really to say that, you know, apply some common sense to say, okay, perhaps this lift was there because there were some extraneous factors also. Perhaps at that point in time, there was a festive season happening and in general, consumer interest was. So there's a judicious blend of applying some common sense also, which is required. So that's why, you can never get bored with this. It's such an amazing art that you can keep doing this. And every time you do it, there's something new you will learn.
I think it's for you, I mean, having been in this space for 20 odd years from your early days at GE, I think this must be where earlier, okay, it was just mostly the analytical models offline. And here it's almost in a day, you're probably making dozens of decisions.
Yes.
In terms of, you know, what to run, because the constant stream of data.
Yes.
So it's a sort of treadmill now that is on.
At the same time, because now there's so much data, every once in a while, I have to keep reminding myself that, you know, don't get so much into the detail that you miss the bigger picture. You can keep digging deeper and deeper into the tool or into the data or into the behavior, and you'll always find something new or the other. But you have to also prioritize the bigger aspect that, okay, is it worth going into it at this much detail? Don't miss the forest because you're just looking at the trees, is what they say, right? So
one question, one final question is, eventually there is a human being at the other end. Even though for us, it's probably when we all look at it, it's some customer ID or something. So do you also suggest that people who are doing analytics and personalization, should they actually have conversations with people also? I mean, because that then can have a big impact.
You are spot on. In fact, it's interesting you brought that up, because in this past year, while we've been all working from home, while we've been doing our routine work of planning, executing campaigns, measuring, improving, etc., one of the things we've also started doing is at least once a month or so, a few of our team members, we call up customers. Literally, we pick up the phone and we call customers and speak to them to understand, why they applied for a product, or in some certain cases they started applying, because our analytics shows us somebody started but didn't complete, right? So you hit the nail on the head there, because we can do a lot of intellectualization in terms of the data shows this that, etc., but sometimes it just makes so much sense. Pick up the phone, talk to 10 customers, and you will learn something. You will learn three things which you never thought of sitting in our office or at home. We would never have imagined, because the context of a customer sitting in Ludhiana trying to apply for a business loan, or somebody sitting in Chennai and trying to apply for a card, can be very different from what we can imagine or interpret from the data. So absolutely right. Speaking to customers is something we are starting to do fairly regularly. Either we talk to them directly, or, you know, customers who speak to our call centers, we listen to recordings of the call centers, because that gives us tremendous insights. Based on that, we've revised a lot of our communication on our website also. We've put in a lot of FAQs, customers that typically customers are asking these set of 5-6 questions. It gave us a lot of insights to make sure we put that out on our website so customers can understand that. And this is all part of the testing that we keep doing to see if we add these FAQs, is that helping to increase the retention and the engagement rate and all that? Absolutely.
I think this is great. I think essentially to the three A's, there is one more A, the three A's of analytics, automation, and AI.
Yeah.
And the fourth A, can be thought of as Awaaz, the customer's voice.
Oh, nice. Yes.
And you can combine this. Because many times, when we get so lost in the world of numbers and so much data now available, every click is being tracked, every call is being recorded today. So
there's
so much of it. But then those one-to-one conversations,
correct,
I think, can make a huge difference.
Yes, absolutely. Always.
One final question. if there are one or two suggestions on what pitfalls to avoid when doing personalization and analytics from your learnings, what would they be to a new person who's starting off his or her career in this field?
I think one thing I've found is we tend to try to get everything perfect. You know, when we start doing something like this, we say, I want to do this and this and this, this. So try to get everything perfect. It'll never happen. And so in the pursuit of excellence, we may end up taking
much longer
to even get started, which is a huge opportunity loss. Because the moment you start, there is data coming in which will tell you how much you can improve. So it's something that culturally, you know, we need to ingrain, and we have been ingraining in ourselves that it's something my boss always used to keep saying, start, make mistakes, but make them fast. I'm sure, I mean, most bosses would probably say that.
But it's a great point, I think, that just begin the journey and you'll keep learning rather than waiting, saying, I want to capture all of the data before making a decision.
Yes, either all of the data or I want this communication to be so perfect. So you keep improving that communication, saying this is not just right. That's
a great point.
You'll never reach that perfect. So get started at one point.
Great, great advice. And so great conversation on this theme. I think you've simplified it very nicely. I think that how do we go about collecting the data? How do you then make the decisions? And I think you've simplified it to the level basically saying that experiment. I think the systems today, the technology stacks which are there, the MarTech platforms which are there, they allow you to actually experiment, try to do A/B testing,
yes,
create different segments and so on. And then also mixed or linked with that is also every once in a while listen to the customer. I think those one-to-one conversations which are there,
absolutely, can add richness. You know, sort of keep that. I think the main thing is I've been fortunate that in our organization we've really invested in a whole stack of all of these tools, because that is necessary. Yes. It is a fair amount of outlay, and there again, you know, you can take it step by step. You start with one tool, then you keep integrating others. So one is the organization. We've invested in a bunch of tools, and in the last 2-3 years we've sort of reoriented our working style to be more data oriented rather than just take calls based on I think this will work. And that whole orientation to use data, and like you said, to also keep talking to customers to understand what's happening, the ground realities. And I think we are trying to definitely ensure there's a spirit of inquiry continuously. You know, that's something we keep saying, let's keep learning. So every once in a while, every quarter at least, there's some training on either a tool or a technique or something, and people are applying that on a daily basis to say this is, you know, and it's just a great team. So people learn. I mean, everything I'm saying now is because of the team that I'm working with. Somebody is a specialist on the communication side, and someone's a specialist on the technology side, and there are of course data scientists, and we learn so much just by doing all of this on a day-to-day basis. That whole spirit of inquiry helps to keep us moving forward, I think.
Yeah, and of course, HDFC Bank has always been a pioneer in analytics right from the early days.
Yes.
So I remember, I think, probably 10 or 15 years ago, listening to Ajay Kelkar.
Oh, yes. Yes.
About how they had used analytics. And we were completely amazed because no one used to talk about it at that time. And I think you're carrying the spirit forward.
Right.
Great. And we'll end with on a lighter note with what I call the five ones.
Okay.
So one future trend or tech that excites you.
So what I'm intrigued about, I won't say, I mean, I'm definitely following, is the whole trend towards data privacy. You know, with all of these, there's so much happening where, like you said, Google, Facebook, all of them are now playing God. And at some level, we are reaching that threshold where customers are saying, this is too creepy. Like my mother this morning was saying, she was doing a Google search and she said, I didn't even type it, but Google gave me the answer saying the Ola cab will cost so much to go from point A to point B. how did Google know what I'm thinking? So, you know, it's getting to that. So that whole concept of where do you draw that line? And that's where, you know, Apple has already put their stake and said that, you know, ITP 2.0, etc. We are going to block cookies, etc. Google is working towards it. The whole world is changing. And it's just interesting to see how that is. Yeah, I mean, I'm just part of that journey.
You are absolutely right. Data privacy has now come to the fore in the last, I think, year, in a way where probably no other trend has sort of risen up.
Correct. And it will be interesting to see. GDPR is already in place. CCPA is in place. But it's interesting to see how the entire world is shaping up with all of this. So it's something that's we will learn as we go along.
Absolutely. Yeah. One trend or tech that has disappointed you in the past few years?
I think two, 3 years ago, there was so much of hype around virtual reality and artificial reality. And, you know, the people saying branches will be virtual, you know, stores will be virtual. Some degree, maybe in some disciplines, it is there, probably medical or some other disciplines, it's probably there. But I think for the average person, I've not seen at least something very huge come out of this whole VR, AR. In gaming, there is to some extent and all. But in my field, at least, I'm not seeing that.
I think maybe it's a sign of things to come. You're right in the disappointment, but this company, Roblox, which is for preteens.
Okay.
They just did a huge IPO recently.
Okay.
And it's been a huge success with preteens. So what they call the sort of the metaverses or these parallel universes.
Yes.
So we are starting to see some of that, but probably it'll take longer than what we had thought in our worlds.
Yes.
But you're right. AR and VR have been somewhat disappointing versus the enthu or the demos that we used to see.
Exactly. We used to, every month used to get somebody coming with a demo and a concept.
Yeah.
And that was the same time when everyone was talking about voice video vernacular. And obviously videos and vernacular has shot up. To that extent, VR has not. Perhaps also because the investment required in building that whole VR capability is significantly higher than videos. Perhaps that may be one reason and use cases. But yeah.
One good book recommendation for people?
I read a lot, but I tend to read for relaxation. So I read a lot of fiction, Agatha Christie and Somerset Maugham and all of those. But since on this topic, I think the one book that I honestly didn't finish reading it, but the concept was mindset. The whole, there was a book about fixed mindset versus growth mindset. I think the book was titled Mindsets. And to me, that one book, it made me sit up and think, and it's one that stayed with me. There's a lot of books we read. It'll be there in our mind for maybe 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and then something else will come in and this gets forgotten. But this particular book, Mindset, the core theme of it, that either you can choose to live with a fixed mindset that this is who I am and this is me. I have to keep proving myself every time that this is who I am. Or you can have a growth mindset that I am an evolving person and I will keep evolving every day, every week. That was to me eye-opening. And it comes back to me every day, like every day, whether in work or on a personal front, whatever I'm doing, something new you learn and you realize, yes, okay, this is different. I can change this part, you know. So I found that I would definitely recommend that as a book.
Wonderful, Reco. One good person podcast to follow.
I follow Avinash Kaushik, the, you know, analytics and...
game theory, I think also, right?
Not
Avinash Dikshit. Avinash Kaushik is different.
Yeah. Avinash Kaushik, I think he was with, again, he's entrepreneur like yourself. Yes. And I think many years at Google.
Yes.
He's got a blog called The Occam's Razor.
Of course, right.
Very, very interesting articles. He writes in a way, simple way for us to understand without making it too technical. And it's varied enough that sometimes it's about tools, technology, or data, or analytics. And sometimes it's just about professional life and
great.
You know, corporate life, and very, very interesting.
Avinash Kaushik, Occam's Razor, that's for everyone.
Yes.
And finally, one key driving belief in your life.
I think somehow for me, it's the key one message of the Bhagavad Gita, which is, you know, just do your duty and don't worry about the results, because you know what they say, karmanyeva adhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana. So it sounds very idealistic, but I found it makes sense from multiple ways, right? One, either while doing your work, if you keep worrying about the result, you're not focusing enough on the work itself. So if the input is not good enough, then the output is not going to be good. So don't worry about the output, just focus on the input is one way to look at it. The other way is just, I find if you immerse yourself in what, for me at least, if I immerse myself in what I'm doing, I enjoy that. Then even if the outcome is good, bad, it doesn't matter, because I've enjoyed the journey. So even if the final result of the campaign is good or not, I have enjoyed that process of conceptualizing, operationalizing, measuring the campaign, and that is rewarding in itself. So somehow that particular sort of philosophy works for me.
Beautifully put, Subhadra, and I think it also applies to work also, where do the campaigns and then of course the customers will take care of their actions. Thank you very much. It was a great conversation today on MarTech Brain with you.
My pleasure. It was good chatting with you.
And thanks everyone. And we'll be back with another edition of MarTech Brain very soon. Thank you.